very much for... Ooh, recording in progress. That's very fancy sounding. Thank you very much for the invitation to speak here today. I am really excited to get to share some of the, so as it says in the title, some of the methodological considerations. And I've done a little bit of a bait and switch on you as well. There's going to be some theory in here too, but don't all immediately log out. It'll be fine. But some considerations that have come up in the course of working on this project. But before I dive into that, I have received permission to take slight advantage of my platform and do a brief call out for the journal Care, an Australasian journal for medieval and early modern studies, for whom I am the outgoing editor. We have a call for papers out, which I think could be very relevant to attendees of this conference. So if you're interested, we would love to hear from you. After the talk, I'll pop a link to the journal in the chat. And we also accept unthemed articles throughout the year. But we do also have a themed call for papers that should be coming out fairly soon. And the topic is ritual practice, performance, and perception. So if that speaks to you, please do keep an eye on Carrie. We would love to hear from you. So moving swiftly onwards, I'm also going to take a little bit advantage of being an invited speaker to just kind of meander through these considerations a bit and hopefully hopefully give you some thought-provoking ideas to chew on in your own interests and your own research. I'm going to start off with a brief summary of the project that I'm just finishing up now and that has kind of brought me to look at these particular situation of magic and witchcraft in medieval normative medieval sources. Then specifically look at what it means to consider the Nordic laws as normative sources, and then the particular challenges when we add witchcraft and magic into that mix. And then I'll wind up with some final thoughts. The woodcutting that you see on this slide here is actually from an early modern English witch pamphlet. It's just one of my favorite images of a witch taking care of her familiars, giving them a little snack. The title of the project has been Before the Witch Trials, Witchcraft as a Legal Concept in Medieval Nordic Law. And looking at law specifically, partially because the witch trials in the Nordic countries are a distinctly early modern phenomenon. There are a few exceptions, particular trials for particularly crimes connected to love or sex magic, but the real sort of thrust of witch trials really occurs much later than the legal material that I am looking at. And so I'm sort of looking at exactly how these concepts that were then implemented in the early modern period changed and related to each other in the earliest codified legal material that we have for the region. So the period of study is roughly 1200 to 1350. And it's roughly because on the earlier end, there are arguments for certain, for parts of certain laws, maybe being able to date earlier, or particular layers of other laws being of an older character than perhaps the rest of the law. So there's a bit of debate there. But in general, you know, 1200 is a kind of nice round number. So we just sort of let that stay where that is. And then, excuse me, and then 1350 is the sort of flexible upper range. So really kind of the initial codification of many of these laws. This period also overlaps with changes in the dominant paradigm of witchcraft. And not only changes in the dominant paradigm, but also consolidation. So that over the high into the late Middle Ages, the demonic or the devil pact sort of paradigm of witchcraft becomes a dominant way to understand witchcraft in a lot of ecclesiastical writings, particularly coming out of the Avignon papacy. And over time, as these are becoming theorized across Europe, they gain coherence, and this becomes the sort of picture of witchcraft that we're very familiar with from the later Middle Ages and into the early modern period. But at this point, it's still still sort of gaining in traction. There are from the early medieval period lots of different ways of kind of thinking about exactly what falls under the umbrella term of magic and how these relate to each other, which I will talk about in more detail a little bit later in the talk as well. So the project sources are pretty straightforward. The sort of provincial laws and town laws, and then later the laws of the realm, as well as the Icelandic laws, and then other ecclesiastical regulations, such as synods or ordinances put out by particular sees, and seeing what vocabulary is used in them and how they relate to each other. And the image here is from Graugaus from Konungabók, with the little arrow pointing to where the text relating specifically to magic begins. So moving swiftly onwards. Oh, there we are. Okay. Sorry, I just got completely flummoxed by technology there for a moment. moving swiftly onwards. So Nordic laws as normative sources. So in effect, it's pretty straightforward, and that the laws set out norms and regulations, you know, how people are meant to behave. If they don't, what the consequences are. These are often formulated in if-then clauses. So if this happens, then it is remedied in this way. If this happens, then this consequence. And depending on the particular law that we are looking at, so law collection, sometimes these are very detailed, sometimes they're very perfunctory. occasionally this might be a consequence of what has been suggested as reflecting an earlier form of a legal tradition, and they kind of become more straightforward over time. But yeah, in general, it can vary quite a bit, the degree of detail that we get, which can make my job a little bit more difficult when I'm trying to get a sense of exactly what the context is bringing to bear on particular terms. But you know, hey, that's research. But what's also important, because a lot of times when we think of normative sources, we think of the societal ideals as this almost reified object, but normative knowledge is a dynamic process. As we have laws, as we have regulations and ordinances, we are seeing a process of creation, of upholding, and even of forgetting and discarding when certain norms are no longer prioritized. There's a moderate tendency, particularly within legal history, to look at change over time in an almost teleological narrative of progress. And this can sort of fall together with a similarly teleological process in how we occasionally talk about magic as a stage in a kind of like teleological process of progress of rationality, where you have magic, which is totally irrational, and then you have religion, which is sort of a rationalization of the irrational, and then you have the Enlightenment, in which we have discovered our rationality, and then it's beautiful and wonderful. And this has obviously been questioned quite a bit. Of course, I think what springs to mind immediately is Richard Kiefer's article, "The Specific Rationality of Medieval Magic," but other authors have talked about this too. And at least within scholarship, it's the particular rationality of magic within a particular social system is gaining greater traction, which is fabulous. Getting back to Nordic laws and normative sources, it is often unclear how the laws were actually enforced in the real world. Within the laws themselves, we do not get we get indications of how this should be done. We get your normative regulations for how the law is to be enforced, but the particularly when we're looking at accusations of witchcraft or certain kinds of harmful magic, we rely more on annals, court records, charters, and they are very thin on the ground for this period, which means that when we're looking at normative sources, or when we're looking at the laws, it makes a lot more sense to conceptualize them more as normative sources, as witnesses to processes of normative knowledge creation or upholding, and yes, as well, so going back to what I mentioned on the previous slide with different degrees of information contained within particular particular measures. Occasionally we get descriptions of relevant concepts, we get kind of more, we get some laws that really become quite, they really quite enjoy their own idiom and can give us a very interesting picture of exactly what they're talking about. But it's still important to ask the extent to which these were mostly or wholly imposed labels, and the extent to which they matched how people saw themselves. And of course, before we move on, brief description of the image. This is a little, this is the problems capital. This is the whole capital, the witchcraft chapter, which is a tiny, tiny addition to the law of Jutland in the early 14th century. So this isn't this isn't in the manuscript, which is the standard edition of the Jutland law, I believe. But it does appear in more than one manuscript from the early 14th century, and then forward in time. And it doesn't say anything particularly out of the ordinary, but it is a very good example of the dynamic nature of the laws, even as we see them as kind of normative sources. But normative does not mean static. So, yes, now we come to the particular challenges that witchcraft and magic present when we look at them in a legal context. And thought I'd look at witchcraft first. And the sort of classic questions when we're thinking of witchcraft: what is it and who decides? A later example from early modern England, I think, is kind of instructive in this instance, because where you see in a particular kind of elite and learned level witchcraft being applied to the practice of magic quite generally and often in a pejorative sense, when you start to have people either within literary contexts or sort of reports from people describing themselves, people might be accused of witchcraft, but they self-identify as cunning folk, the cunning women and cunning men. And so from sort of apart from this particular learned context, there is a different paradigm of who is a witch and who is, for example, a cunning woman, where these are, there's a division between them, and which is a decidedly negative term and negative accusation. And this is worth bearing in mind when we look to older sources as well, because it reminds us that when we're looking at laws, we're looking at sources that are produced from a distinctive social nouveau, and within a particular context, which might that particular top-down context might be at odds with how people on the ground thought about themselves. And then, of course, we have the challenges of translation between the medieval and early modern languages. This is why you should always proofread your slides before you actually give your presentation. Challenges of translation between both medieval and modern languages, that should be. So it's not only how we translate a wide variety of medieval terms that we have into the modern languages in which we are analyzing them, although that is also something that can cause a lot of problems. For example, if we subsume many different concepts under, for example, witchcraft, that we run the risk of obscuring potential distinctions between them that might have existed in our sources but aren't as visible to us when we're just trying to categorize them. But also between modern languages, we have interesting problems. Problems, challenges. For example, in English, we do have this this contrast that we can draw between witch and cunning folk, and we can trace that back into our early modern sources, and then we can also trace the history of witch and witchcraft back to Old English, and we can sort of see how that has changed over time, and how these interpretations have changed with context. And we can see quite clearly when we're using, for example, witchcraft or magic as an etic analytical term, and when we are drawing upon a specifically pre-modern concept, that distinction isn't always made in scholarship, but in theory we can. But this is a little bit more challenging, for example, in Swedish, where the word trolldom, which is usually translated as witchcraft, is the word that we have frequently in medieval Swedish laws, and is still fairly common as an emic term today. And this kind of contrast between witch and cunning folk that we have in English is much more difficult to kind of trace back in Swedish, for example. This sense of a context in which the laws are created being potentially different from the context in which the people that they are potentially describing or labeling live is more difficult to kind of get a sense of. That has been a bit of a challenge. In that particular context. In the Icelandic and Norwegian context, I think that's where we get a lot of these, particularly church laws, that are really quite detailed. It's less of a distinct problem in that case. There, what's really interesting is, being able to kind of cross-reference with the work that's been done, for example, by Dillman, going through all of the magic vocabulary in the sagas and kind of seeing like, oh yes, I recognize this. but witchcraft in general, the major challenge is that the combination of a normative source and potentially imposed category makes it difficult for us to really kind of access the person behind the or the person that the laws are potentially aimed towards. There we are. I will just take a slight moment to say that trying to find appropriate images for magic and witchcraft can be very interesting sometimes. Skipping to the second bullet point, is magic actually anything? Is it so flexible that it can indeed be applied to kitty litter? It is at least a foundational part of early Christianity, and that's my time is moving on. Sorry, I'll I'll be quick, Jennifer, I promise. So it's a foundational part of early Christianity, and part of this is that so magic in the ancient Roman and Greek world is usually characterized as something that sort of stood outside of the official sanctioned cults. It was frequently private, it was frequently for profit. Early Christianity, early Christians were often accused of practicing magic. And so part of the challenge of kind of legitimizing themselves was to say, no, what we do is official, that is good. What everyone else does, that is magic. I mean, it's a very simplified sort of way of putting it, but this kind of appropriation is something that became very, very important in sort of theorization of what magic is, even if it was theorized in slightly different ways, depending on who was doing it, was quite an important part of sort of Christian identity creation and group boundary establishment. But of course, due to the kind of local Christianities of the early Middle Ages, different people meeting the Christian religion in different ways and sort of making it their own, meant that magic was a constantly changing umbrella term and unstable in the sense that it was could change very could vary quite a bit from region to region. It was constantly being debated and re-theorized, but it generally covered a wide variety of quite specific behaviors, which again, depending on the region, could be similar, could be very different. Even when they use the same vocabulary, so that can be quite fun. But this has implications for how we go about identifying magic in medieval sources, because particularly when we have sources like Graugas, where the sort of relevant bit appears in the Christian laws section, then it is interesting to think about, referring back to the kind of changing paradigm of magic and witchcraft over time, how magic is changing in relationship to its alignment with paganism or heresy. Is it, and sort of goes over to, or doesn't go over to, but the association between magic and heresy becomes closer and closer and closer and closer over time. And up to the point that one of the first images that we have of a witch riding a broomstick, she's dressed as a Waldensian. By that point in Champion de Dame, the categories had even started to overlap. And so while we do have magic and witchcraft appearing in Christian laws, East Norse sort of side of things, we do have witchcraft or trolldom appearing in Christian laws occasionally, but much more frequently they're dealt with in a much more concrete manner. When it leads to physical harm, but also frequently, this is also the case in West Norse as well, that they're mentioned in with reference to slander, and this is one example of a particular kind of vocabulary interestingness in old Swedish, the this word för göra, which is often kind of translated as a kind of witchcraft or sorcery, but in general is more kind of destruction, more generally, of which witchcraft can be a type, but förgörning is often associated with trolldom in the medieval Swedish laws, but it also appears by itself, and trolldom appears without förgörning. So there's an interesting relationship, you know, going on there. Following the research that I had done on shapeshifting, I have interesting ideas about what Han is doing here, and particularly thinking in the context of like the sort of psychological understanding of Han. That is for another day, I think. So what can normative sources like laws tell us about the practice of magic? The short answer is it's complicated. But they can tell us about the norm setting goals of the lawmakers and interactions with similar goals elsewhere, potentially. Particularly as these kind of descriptions of, you know, what witches are, what witches do, are traveling in learned circles as well as emerging from local contexts. Can also reveal differences between regions, differences between regions and manuscripts can reveal processes of normative knowledge, how these change over time, but also how different what different vocabulary choices can reveal about ideas around magic in this particular sort of social context. We can also ask who is applying labels and to whom. Of course, in many cases, we don't have particular names of people who are setting out the laws, but this this question of position is certainly one that's important to keep in mind. And similarly, when we cross-reference with other sources, what is it exactly that we are corroborating? Are we corroborating actual practice, for example, or are we moving more or less within the kind of within similar social contexts and not really kind of moving outside of them as much as we think we are. So then if the terms magic and witchcraft present us with so much uncertainty and lack of clarity, what do we do? Do we just stop using them as analytical terms? I mean, not necessarily. I think that we should probably think a little bit more critically about how we apply these terms, and particularly the term magic. That someone asked me once as a kind of joking, provocative question: is it possible to talk about magic outside of a Christian context? I think that there is a wealth of anthropological literature that shows us, yes, absolutely, you can. But we do need to have an awareness of the fact that when we operate within a Christian context, we do need to have an awareness that magic is not wholly an etic term. So if we're going to use it as a heuristic tool, a certain degree of care and distinction is necessary. Generally speaking, I personally do try to avoid using witchcraft in my research, mostly because I have a kind of pervading sense of this being a very much top-down pejorative term, and I'm just very cautious about kind of reinscribing, unintentionally reinscribing these prejudices in my analysis. And so as a kind of summarizing takeaway, I think that we can have less anxiety over, you know, getting a precise definition of magic, but perhaps also a little bit less ambivalence regarding just how flexible and context dependent meanings of magic and labels of magic can be. Mm-hmm. That'll be that for me. Thank you very much for your attention.